Welcome. Welcome to all. It is with joy that I welcome you on behalf of Trinity United Church in Kitchener, Ontario. Wherever you are, however often you have tuned in, we are happy that you can join us in this time of worship together. Why are we here? Why spend this time in worship? We are here to follow the way of Jesus, who brings us together in the community of the church. He opens our hearts to know that our true selves are found in God, who is love. He saves us from fear, from selfishness, from meaninglessness. He leads us with compassion and acts with love. He moves us to curiosity and creativity to build with others a more just world. Let us walk and work together as we follow the way of Jesus. Let us worship God with humility and joy. God of Still Waiting, More Voices 20. We heed your call, O God. We come with praise and gratitude. We come as your people, looking for new life and new ways of living into the love we share in Jesus. We come as your imperfect children, aware of our moments of selfish ambition, our surrender to fear and doubt, our contribution to mistrust and confusion. We come with our secrets and our faults. You see us as we truly are, yet your grace abounds, O God. So we come as we are. We come with our shortcomings, yes, but also with our gifts, remembering that we are created in your image. We come that your word may nourish us. We come desiring to walk your ways of healing and reconciliation, to hear your words of wisdom and renewal. We know that you are with us in the rush of life. So we come craving your blessing and direction. In faith and trust, we open our hearts and minds to you. May this time of worship renew and strengthen us to live with gratitude and purpose. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. O Jesus, I have promised. Voices United 120. Which has touched me. It is written by Carole. Our bodies are so fragile. Our time here is so brief. Our lives are but a single drop in the ocean of eternity. And yet, we are known, we are loved, we are held. May our fears be transformed, and may all our suffering be transfigured. May we discover within ourselves a deep well of peace, a great storehouse of resources, the grace to recognize the gifts that our circumstances bring, the insight to perceive that as time shrinks in length, it expands in depth, the wisdom to discern what matters and what does not. The resourcefulness to seek beauty, hope, and love wherever we can find them. The generosity of heart to accept gratefully our limitations. The courage to let go, to move on. Sometimes I wish.
As we try to be free. I wish my eyes hadn't been opened just for an hour. Oh, how sweet it would be not to be struggling, not to be striving, but just sleep securely in our slavery. But now that I've seen with my eyes, I can't close them, because deep inside me, somewhere I still know the road that my sisters and I
readings for today are taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verses 1 to 8 and John chapter 2 verses 13 to 22.
The reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verses 1 to 8. Everything has its time. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. God still speaks. Thanks be to God.
Nobody turn me round. Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
Nobody turn me round.
I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking,
marching to the freedom land.
Don't turn me around. No hatred.
Turn me around. Turn me round, turn me round, turn me round, keep on walking, keep on talking,
marching to the freedom land. Nobody turn me round,
nobody turn me round,
nobody turn me round.
Turn me round.
around.
No, no, don't turn me around. No, no, don't turn me around. 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 No, no, don't turn me around.
Nobody turn me round, nobody turn me round, nobody turn me round, nobody turn me round.
Marching to the freedom land,
marching to the freedom land,
marching to the land,
marching to the freedom land.
In the second reading, Jesus cleanses the temple. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body, after he was raised from the dead. His disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. God still speaks. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, speak your word to us, we pray. And we ask that your Holy Spirit enlighten our minds, that we may receive what you are saying to us with humility. In the name of Christ. Amen. Time is one of the great mysteries of life. We live within it, but we cannot control it. It moves us along, all the while holding us accountable. Time is a gift and an opportunity. Every moment and every day is a gift for which we should be thankful. And every moment and every day presents us with opportunities to live meaningfully and purposefully. But for that to happen, we have to understand and accept that it takes all of the varying and contrasting experiences that life throws at us to fashion us and bring forth the best in us, not just the ones that are good and easy, desirable and comfortable. We don't get to select only the good and refuse the bad. Life throws them all at us. And even though we may not see it at the time, our lives are better for that, because each experience reflects something of the sacred purpose of God and offers us the opportunity for love to be revealed. And so for that reason, the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes reminds us that for everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. And he goes on to say, God made everything suitable for its time. Or as my grandparents used to drill in us, there is a time and a place for everything. And that everything, my friends, includes anger. Anger. Not the uncontrolled impulse to hurt or destroy, arising out of hurt, pride, abuse of power, or the desire for revenge. But the strong emotion that you feel when you encounter a situation where someone has behaved in an unfair, cruel, or unacceptable way. There are some folks I know, many good folks, who discourage anger of any sort and for any reason, because they see it as unbecoming and unacceptable. It is understandable why persons will be turned off by anger. It is understandable why persons may be scared or uneasy in the face of anger. We have seen how hurtful and destructive and alienating anger can be when it is excessive, when it is displaced and misdirected, when it is allowed to control and define us. But anger is as human as anything else. It is an emotion and a reaction that we all will continue to feel and experience. All of us experience some level of anger at various times and for various reasons. Sometimes our anger is appropriate to the circumstances, and sometimes it's not. There is a balance to anger that we have to learn to negotiate, so that we don't get angry about things we shouldn't, and we are not complacent over things about which we should be angry. In today's gospel reading, we see an angry Jesus. Jesus had gone to the temple, and he had seen in the very house of God that greed had displaced goodness. People were being exploited, and profit had become more important than people and prayer. And Jesus was angry. You see, the temple was the place where, in accordance with the law of God, people offered sacrifices. For the Jews, the law of Moses stated what kinds of sacrifices should be made in the temple. And some of those sacrifices involved animals, a young sheep or a young goat or a pair of pigeons. For persons who lived in Jerusalem, that was easy. But for persons who had to travel long distances, sometimes over many days, as was the case with many who were there for the Feast of the Passover, it was often difficult to carry the appropriate sacrifice. So when persons went to the temple to offer their sacrifices, the temple authorities made it easy for them by having sacrificial animals for sale right there on the premises. That is why persons were selling animals and birds in the temple. In addition, persons were required to pay a temple tax, but there was one important requirement. They had to use temple coins to pay the temple tax, because Roman coins bore the image of Caesar and was considered to be idolatrous. That is why, and that is where the money changers came in. If persons did not have temple currency available, they could change their Roman currency into temple money right there in the temple's outer courtyard. But as is so often the case, wherever there is a need, there often is greed. There are those who are ready to exploit the needs that are there for their own personal gain. And that is what was happening in the temple. And that is what angered Jesus. For what started out as a service to make worship easy degenerated into a selfish pursuit of gain. And Jesus walks into the temple and he sees the merchants selling the sheep and goats and pigeons. He sees the money changers at their counters. He hears the noise, the shouting, the haggling, and he becomes very angry. He makes a whip of cords and drives them all out, scatters the coins of the money changers, and rebukes them, saying, "Stop making my father's house a marketplace." Or as Matthew more pointedly puts it, he said to them, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of thieves, a den of robbers." Jesus did not hide his anger. And in becoming angry, he has shown us that there are times when it is appropriate and necessary for us to be angry too. As strange as it may sound, anger can be and often is an act of love. Appropriate anger often flows out of love. You cannot love somebody and be indifferent to the ill treatment that that person faces. You cannot fulfill the great commandment to love your neighbor as yourself and not become angry when your neighbors are mistreated, exploited, neglected, marginalized, discriminated against. Jesus went to the temple and he saw how people were being exploited and he was angry. His anger was not motivated by hatred for those who were exploiting others. His anger was motivated by his love for those who were being so exploited. My friends, for all of us who are followers of Jesus, I ask you, when last have you been angry? Really angry. Not just about the little slights and hurts and insults that you have faced, but angry about the wrongs and indifference and injustice and discrimination and neglect and ill treatment that others face, especially the vulnerable. Do we get angry with those who oppress others? Do we get angry with those who can help but choose to turn their backs or look on with indifference? What about those who go hungry, who die from preventable and curable diseases? Those who suffer abuse and neglect at the hands of those who are supposed to protect and care for them? Do we get angry at those things? Angry enough to take a stand, to speak out, to give of ourselves and our resources so that change can come about? Being angry is not about flying off the handle and wanting to harm or hurt anyone. It is about being sufficiently moved to do whatever you can to change things. Jesus was angry, and he let his anger be known. He was moved to change things, knowing that he would have to pay the price. My friends, we are observing the period of Lent. It is unfortunate that for many, Lent has been reduced to a set of ritualistic observances, giving up of things that do not cost us anything to give up, and with the added comfort of knowing that we will return to them when the period of Lent is over. But my friends, I urge us, I pray that we will make Lent different. Rather than only committing to give up something for a week, or a few weeks rather, let us commit to doing something that will bring about real change. Not only for ourselves, but for others as well. Especially those who can't bring about those changes themselves. And if it means that we have to let our anger show, then so be it. Because there is a time to be angry. There are lots that need to be overturned in our societies, in the systems that oppress and exploit and discriminate. And yes, in our churches too. And so let's pray for the courage and the love to be angry when we should. And let's do what we need to do to change things. Thanks be to God. Will you come and follow me? Voices United 567.
So move and live and grow in you and you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we live our lives surrounded by so many competing, contrasting voices, all vying for our attention. Today we pray for a moment of quiet, to catch our breath, to listen and give thanks. Grant us quiet, O God. With our lives that are burdened with worry and fear, today we pray for a moment of laughter, to delight in the simple things, in our family, in our friends, in our pets, to recall that you have created us for joy and wonder and delight. Grant us laughter, O God. And God, in a world where so much is wrong, where there is so much hurt and pain, we pray, God, for a moment of anger, a time when we will see and be moved by the wrongs that are around us, as Christ was. And gracious God, with our lives marked by so much disconnection and isolation, today we pray for a moment of connection, unexpected or planned. Remind us that we are always part of something bigger, so much bigger than ourselves. Grant us connection, O God. And we pray for a moment to know that we are loved truly and deeply, just as we are, without measure or condition. Surround us with your love, O God. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. My friends, a new week is before us. What can we do to brighten our little corner, to spread love, to encourage someone, to point the way to a better tomorrow? We have control over the light that is our life, and we can let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine.
Amen. 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 Tell you something, children, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, yeah. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. I let it shine. Let it shine to show my lover. I'm gonna tell you that everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. And everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine, yeah. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine to show my lover. I got to tell you that even in my home, I'm gonna let it shine. And even in my home, shine. I let it shine. I let it shine to show my lover. I got to tell you that when I see my neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine. Ha. I think I see my neighbor coming. I better let it shine, yeah. When I see my neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine. I let it shine, I let it shine to show my lover. How I like to say amen, amen. I wonder what everybody joined me on the last chorus. Everybody? Hey, amen. A little louder. Hey, amen. With the spirit. Hey, amen. Amen. Hey, amen.
Until we meet again, God bless us, each and everyone. Amen.